William Morrow and Harper Audio present Operation Vengeance, The Astonishing Aerial Ambush That Changed World War II by Dan Hampton. Read by John Pruden. Author's note. Time passes, Marcel Proust once wrote, and little by little everything that we have spoken in falsehood becomes true. This was certainly the case for those who flew Operation Vengeance on the morning of April 18, 1943. During the years following World War II, those who survived wished only to pick up the pieces of their lives and return to some sense of normalcy. Consequently, there was little interest in revisiting the very near past with its painful memories, and events that might have been recorded with stark clarity were not. Those involved were fighting a war under the worst conditions and had little time for journals, even if they had the inclination. They were too busy staying alive to give much thought to posterity, and indeed, thinking of the future is a dangerous preoccupation in combat. Historically, the significance of Admiral Isoroku Yamamoto's death is staggering and has evolved into a vicious 77-year-old debate over who killed the architect of the December 1941 sneak attack on Pearl Harbor that propelled the United States into World War II. Tens of thousands of American lives were saved from battles that were never fought, and the deadliest conflict in human history was considerably shortened. Our present world would be greatly altered if the United States had not achieved total victory from that war, and an enormous piece of this credit belongs to one extraordinary American fighter pilot. Both Captain Tom Landfear and Lieutenant Rex Barber were awarded partial credit for this feat, sparking a bitter feud that continues today among their various supporters. Landfear, in particular, vociferously defended his actions because his post-war political ambitions were founded on the claim that he alone destroyed the most hated man in America. Unfortunately, existing military reports, when written at all, tended toward the terse, brief style favored by men short of paper who despised typewriters and were quite rightly more concerned with surviving another day than with composition. This left me a few solid, uncontestable points such as timing, routes of flight, and the names and characters of those involved. There was much to overcome here as various falsehoods had become fact in the decades following the war. Nonetheless, a number of men who were part of the mission or in the Pacific Theater at the time emerged to tell the truth. Men who had made peace with their ghosts and were now in a position to ultimately set the record straight. Regrettably, they were not aided by the government or military in this endeavor, as both organizations are loath to challenge, refute, or amend their own official records. Official reality is not always the same as the truth, and this was certainly the case with the Yamamoto mission. Lamentably, as of this printing, rightful credit is still being withheld from the two men who deserve it, and the truth of the matter largely relegated to obscurity. In a land that prizes honor, especially on the battlefield, this will not suffice. Based on primary data, unpublished interviews with survivors, and substantial original research, I have summarized the historical context, accurately reconstructed the mission and the attack, and mathematically proven which pilot actually killed Isoroku Yamamoto. My purpose for entering the situation is to ensure that those pilots who risked so much and materially shortened the Pacific War by their actions receive the long overdue personal recognition and official accolades they merit for their valor. Perhaps Sophocles said it best, "The long unmeasured pulse of time moves everything. There is nothing hidden that it cannot bring to light." I truly hope so. Dan Hampton, Vail, Colorado. Foreword by Rex Barber Jr. and Rex Barber III. When Dan asked us to write the foreword for this book, a flood of thoughts went through our minds. First, How do you say the right thing about someone you knew as Dad and Grandpa and who also had a part in changing world history? A farm kid from Culver, Oregon, did what so many of the greatest generation did. They volunteered for service, went to combat, and just did their job. Heroes come in all shapes and sizes. A few boast about their accomplishments, but most said they did their job and went on to the next day. Mission Day was in all likelihood a suicide mission. I have often wondered what was going through Rex's mind as he turned his P-38 to attack the bomber with six Zeros above and behind him, diving to attack in a desperate attempt to save Yamamoto. Then, as he passed over the smoking bomber, three of the Zeros were on his tail, putting 52 bullets into his plane. I'm sure he was mad that he had to try to escape rather than fight. I'm also sure that he had confidence in his training, his plane, his skill, and his mother's prayers. The cockpit was most likely filled with profanity interspersed with prayer. Odd, you might say, unless you have experienced combat. Rex's love of flying started early, listening to his Uncle Edgar's stories about flying in France in World War I. Uncle Edgar was known to embellish a story and may have overstated his World War I exploits. Regardless, it planted the seed in a young farm boy, resulting in an early flight off the barn with a makeshift parachute and a broken arm. Having flown in a beach bonanza with Rex after his retirement, it was obvious that he was a part of the plane, confident in his ability and smooth in his touch on the stick. History is often an odd web. Yamamoto and all of Japan were hated in the United States after Pearl Harbor. Yet growing up, Rex had a Japanese-American classmate, Doc Akiyama, whom he helped save after Doc fell and broke his back while they were fishing in the rugged Crooked River Canyon in 1940. 3 years later, Doc and his family were in an internment camp, and Rex was looking over his shoulder at smoke coming out of the jungle on Bougainville. In another place and time, Yamamoto would have been a friend. There were many common interests: bridge, poker, and a good wager, and love of country. I believe Yamamoto would have played bridge like Rex. Bid no trump if you can because of the finesse required to make it work. Whether you were lucky enough to sit in his lap at 5 years old and hear this account of history firsthand, or you are hearing it now, the man known as Rex, Sir, Colonel, Coach, Friend, and Hero was truly part of the greatest generation. Thank you, Dad, Grandpa. Prologue, April 18, 1943, the South Pacific. A bead of sweat rolled down the fighter pilot's face. Gathering momentum, it furrowed a light stripe over his cheekbone, down around his mouth, and when it could go no farther, the bead hung suspended from the end of his stubbled chin. Stretching until gravity triumphed, it dropped onto a narrow strip map on the man's left thigh and splattered across a blue area marked Solomon Sea. Though it wasn't yet 7 a.m., man and machine were already draped in a thick blanket of wet heat. Condensation made the metal surfaces of the cockpit clammy, and the control wheel was slick with moisture. Cracked and taped, the patched leather seat cushion had lost its firmness months earlier, and now stank of mildew and heavy jungle funk. Everything stank. Smoke from the cooking fires mixed with decaying vegetation, metal from the aircraft, and occasionally a whiff from the open-air latrines. It could be worse. There was no cloying reek from dead flesh or the acrid stench of burned hair that hung over the island when Lieutenant Rex Barber had arrived 4 months earlier, 3 months and 28 days to be exact. The natives called this place Isatabu, and the few maps around said it was Guadalcanal. The American military universally referred to it as the shithole, or in calmer moments, simply the canal. Today was Easter Sunday, April 18, 1943. But Rex, along with every other man stuck here, hated the island with a passion and was having no religious thoughts whatsoever. Pushing against the rudder pedals, The pilot raised his butt off the cushion and tugged a small lever that raised the seat a bit. Looking out at the wings, then around to the tail, he cycled the flight controls and watched everything move. Satisfied, Barber flipped the shoulder straps across his chest with practiced ease, threaded the canvas loops through the lap belt, then locked the whole thing loosely around his midsection. Glancing around at the familiar switches, he checked that the battery and master switch were off, set the mixture controls, and bumped both red-handled throttles a half inch forward in preparation for starting the engines. With his eyes shut, the lieutenant could touch any toggle, lever, or button he wished. Constant combat created that kind of intimacy. In a dogfight, there was no time for groping around the cockpit. Despite the early hour, Rex already felt sweat run down between his shoulder blades and gather at his belt. The seat of his khaki pants was also damp, but he ignored all this. This morning was too important. Leaning forward, Rex pulled the wheel back and the control column brushed against his outer right calf. The Lockheed P-38 was the only fighter he had flown that did not have a stick, and the cumbersome column wheel arrangement was odd in a fighter that was otherwise magnificent. Still, nothing was ever perfect. Barber normally flew number 125, which he had named Diablo, but it was down for maintenance, so today he had Miss Virginia, number 147, courtesy of Lieutenant Bob Pettit. With the big wheel tucked against his chest, Rex leaned forward and checked the top of the main switch box to ensure all the lights, starters, and primers were off. The battery was last in the row, and though it was obviously off, he tapped it anyway. Farthest left on the panel was a round plate with a pair of 2-inch magneto levers, one for each engine, that he wriggled to make certain they were also both in the off position. Directly above the magnetos at the top of the plate was the rectangular master switch that would, with the battery, power up all the electrical systems. It also was plainly in off position, but he touched it as well. Dropping his right hand down to the front of the panel, Barber ran his finger along another row of switches, tapping the two guarded covers for his generators. He did the same for the 5 switches mounted behind the control wheel, making certain that his cannon, machine guns, and most important, the master armament switch were all off. Easing the column forward, Rex rolled his left forearm slightly to see the watch that he, like most pilots, wore with its face on the inside of the wrist. 0650. It was time to begin. Leaning over the rolled-down left window, he saw the crew chief looking up expectantly. No one but the pilots was supposed to know that today's mission was anything but an ordinary combat patrol, yet everyone did know. There were more idlers standing around, and the ground crews were snappier, their eyes bright, and not from the fever that raged across the island. It was, Barber knew, a chance for them to really feel like they made a difference in this war. Not that they didn't do that every day, as far as he was concerned, but today was special. Pilots got to hit back every day, killing the enemy and often being killed, but at least they got to fight. Rex had been here since December 1942 and could well appreciate the ground crew's frustration. The crew chief put his hands on the left prop and stared at the pilot, who raised his left arm, gave a thumbs up, then made an exaggerated circle with his left index finger. The man pulled the prop once, then again, and stepped back about 10 feet. Nodding, Barber flipped the battery and master switches forward to the on positions, then watched the fuel quantity gauge needles jump so there was good power to the plane. Glancing down at the floor left of the seat, he confirmed both fuel tank selectors were in main. Then Rex cycled the fuel boost pump switches just behind them. Leaning forward to the bulkhead, forward of the mixture controls, he reset the electric propellers by depressing 2 small circuit breakers, then flipped back the red guarded cover over the left generator switch. Directly above it, the ammeter needle instantly swung right. The electrical system was good. Turning on the booster pump, Barber glanced at his watch, saw the second hand tick upward, and knew it was time to start engines. Rex reached to the floor between his legs, pushed the black oval-shaped engine primer knob, then turned it 90 degrees left. After pumping twice, he reached around the wheel to the main switchbox panel with his right hand and put a finger on the left starter switch. Leaning sideways and looking down, he got a nod and thumbs up from the chief, a young sergeant wearing ragged khaki who was waiting expectantly in front of the left engine. His eyes were fixed on the pilot, sharp and alert, even though Barber knew the ground crews had worked all night attaching a newly arrived 310-gallon drop tank under one wing and the normal 165-gallon tank beneath the other. They were absolutely essential for today's mission. Nodding in return, Rex twirled his left hand above his head again, then toggled the starter switch aft. The big three-bladed Curtis electric propeller lurched once, twice, then began to spin. The fighter rocked as the powerful 12-cylinder Allison sputtered to life, belching out a cloud of blue-black exhaust that slowly drifted toward the tails, and the smell of burnt fuel momentarily smothered the island's stink. Eyeballing the vibrating engine gauges, the lieutenant adjusted the left throttle, then repeated the process to start the right engine. With both engines idling normally at 1,000 RPM, he set the parking brake and flashed another thumbs up to the crew chief. Smoothly advancing the left mixture control to auto-rich, Rex watched the engine revolutions stabilize. As he bumped the throttle forward a half inch to hold 1,000 RPM, the vibration stopped and he exhaled. It was a good start. Miss Virginia was up and running. Quickly working his way through the same procedure for the right engine, Rex then tugged his chin strap and wriggled the flying helmet down closer to his ears. Switching on the radio, he winced as static crackled through the earphones. Quickly turning the volume down, Rex tuned to the briefed common frequency each pilot would monitor today, though no one would speak until they reached the target some 400 miles away. Methodically working his way around the cockpit, he tested the fuel warning light and checked gauges. Peering at the attitude indicator, Rex then tapped the compass to free the needle. Outside, the crew chief had vanished. Rex knew the man was checking for any leaks and closing up panels. Glancing left and right, he saw puffs of blue smoke drifting overhead from the other fighters, and the dull roaring of 36 engines filled the air. 18 P-38 Lightnings, and 18 Army Air Corps pilots, mostly young lieutenants with one captain. The only two field grade officers were Major Lou Kittle, the 12th Fighter Squadron commander who had agreed to split the pilots and the planes with Major John Mitchell's own 339th Fighter Squadron, and Mitchell himself. A compactly built intense combat veteran with 8 aerial kills to his name, Mitchell was the Army's leading ace on Guadalcanal and today's mission commander. The 16 primary planes, plus 2 spares, were divided into 2 groups, 3 flights of 4 fighters who would provide top cover against any Jap fighters, and 1 flight of 4 Lightnings led by Captain Tom Landfear, who would do the hunting. Rex was with this latter 4-ship flight, and his job today was to break through whatever opposition existed, which promised to be heavy indeed, and kill the target. A target that was the solitary vital objective of this raid, and one so critical that 18 officers were cheerfully volunteering their own lives to destroy it, at all costs. For a minute, his eyes and hands darted around the cockpit, oil, coolant, inverters. Everything was fine. With his left hand, Rex touched both 4-way fuel selectors on the floor by his seat, wriggling each toggle to make certain it was locked in the res position. He always took off and flew 15 minutes feeding from the reserve tanks just to be sure they functioned, but today would be a bit different. Today, after takeoff, each pilot would feed from the extra underwing tanks first to make certain they were working. 5 minutes from the smaller 150-gallon tank, then the rest of the inbound route from the 300-gallon tank until it was dry. The idea was to reach the target, jettison the externals, and have plenty of internal fuel for fighting and the return to Guadalcanal. Finally, he flipped the gun sight on, adjusted the rheostat to full bright, then turned it off. Reappearing from beneath the right wingtip and angling backward to avoid the spinning prop, The crew chief stopped just past the nose. Catching Barber's eye, he nodded and flashed a thumbs up, which he held until...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.